right, you may be seated. Amen. We thank God for you. Thank God for you. Thank God for you. God loves you. God is love. Love passes knowledge. You can have the knowledge of all the knowledge in the world. You can have the tongues of angels. You can have all the eloquent speech. You can have the wisdom of men and godly knowledge and have not love. You ain't hitting on nothing. Paul said it. Why did Paul say it? Because he was educated and he hated Jesus, but he loved God. There's a lot of people don't like Jesus, but they love God. You got to accept Jesus. Paul was beating up folk who calling on the name of Jesus, wasn't he? But he messed around and met Jesus. Boy, his life changed, didn't it? Amen, amen. So, we thank God for you. All right. God is faithful to his promises. Are you? Amen. Are you faithful? What I expect out of God, I'm expecting to give back. What I want from God, I'm expecting to be that and be at his disposal when he needs me. If I put orange juice in this cup, this orange juice is a container. What shall I expect out of this container? Okay, so if I hadn't put nothing in, what can I expect out? Okay, so God has put himself in us, right? We are his. Let's settle that. We laid the foundation. God told me to go back. My baby will be teaching on this evening. He said, go back. And God did put that in my spirit. I didn't say anything. He said, check the foundation to make sure, check in the foundation. I'm like, okay, I'm meditating on it. And God finally, 1:30 one night, he said, I told you that so you could tell them. Add that too. He said, I just didn't tell you that. I'm like, okay, God, you got me. So is your foundation got stuff in it? You building on the foundation with something ain't the word of God? The foundation, the church is built on what? The word of God. The word of God is built on revelation of church, excuse me. The church is built off revelation knowledge. Peter, flesh and blood, didn't reveal this to you. Only my Father told you my identity. Now, Peter, upon this statement of truth, upon this rock, that's truth, foundation, what you just spoke, I'm going to be on my church. Now, the church is built off revelation knowledge, not intellectual knowledge, not just knowledge, because I read that book sitting in that union down there in Utica, that little Gideon book. I promise you, I read it over 300 times. Ask me what I got. It had Psalms, Proverbs, Matthew through Revelation. And I read that book thinking I was satisfying God. My God didn't have my heart. And I didn't get nothing. Not one thing. Not one thing. My mind was on what was going on that campus. My mind was flooded with baseball and everything else. But everywhere I went to a service, somebody was calling me out. Are you saying, yes, sir, I am? I was lying. I wasn't saying. That man knew I wasn't saying. That man had the spirit. He kept watching me the whole service. Anyway, I want you to hear me this morning. I want you to hear me. Jeremy, pull up Deuteronomy, please. 30 and 19. Deuteronomy 30 and 19. Adding that to the stick. We're going to add that in there. Over in Jeremiah 28 chapter, the false prophet got up in front of the priest and everybody and told the church, I destroyed the yoke of Babylon. He had no authority to speak on God's behalf. Jeremiah had already told the children of Israel they're going into captivity. God told them why. They kept disobeying God. They kept disobeying God. They kept disobeying God. I call heaven and earth to record. I got a witness. This day against you. Now, he's talking to the children of Israel. Now, we're God, we got his spirit, we sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, we got his mark on us, right? We have the first installment of all the promises to come. Y'all to get excited about that. Look, I got the Holy Spirit, as a first installment of healing, deliverance. Wait a minute, a better life? Come on, y'all. I got the first installment. That I have set before you. Life. Zoe life. A God-filled life. Not this life that we come out of. We know about that life. We've been orientated to that. It's hard to come out of this stuff, man. That's why we had to be born again. This Zoe life, John 1, Pastor was speaking on that the last time she spoke. That life was the light that lighted every man that came into the world. And death, I got a choice. Now, that last word, death, I operated in dead things. I did. I played around in death. Guess what I would get? Guess what kept coming up? Death produced death? Yeah. Spiritually death? Yeah. Come on. Come on. Blessings, cursing. We got life, death. Look at the twins. Life, offset. Life, death, blessing, cursing. Do death go with blessings? Wait a minute. Do life go with cursings? Well, okay, so we know that God wants us to, therefore, make a choice. What did it say? Choose. Wait a minute. What are we going to choose? Based on being his, we know God wants the best, right? He said choose. He's giving us the answer. What do the Holy Spirit normally do for us? As God's children, give us the answers to life, bogging, troubling questions. Choose life. John 10 and 10, don't go there. Jesus said, Satan come to steal. Now, he done told him what the lowdown joker's going to do. I don't need to call a theologian to get that one. He said, Satan came to what? But I have come. To have Zoe life. Adam and Eve had Zoe life. They had God's life. So the first two human beings had God life in them. Adam was a clump of dirt until God put Zoe life. Zoe name is Zoe life. So her name is that very life. And y'all teach her that name so she can embrace that. See, the Bible tells you what to name your children. Some people name that. One lady named her child Angelo. Orangelo. It was a football player back, played for Texas A&M back in the day. I am hip. That was on the back of his jersey. I, period, M, last name was hip. That's what she named her child. He was a punt returner. He was fast, too. Oh, he was good. I don't know what happened, but I was looking for him to make pro, but he was good. But I am hip. I'm like, I'm in the fifth grade. Wait a minute now. But, you know, one lady named her child Gonorrhea. Go figure. It's cute. It's cute. Zoe life. Choose 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 life. The Holy Spirit's job is to strengthen your born-again spirit. Your inner man has been born again. It had to be in order to house the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So your inner man, where Satan used to sit on the seat of your heart, is cleaned up. And that inner man is being strengthened as you obey. That inner man, where wasn't born again, has been recreated and reborn to house God. Woo! God said, I'm coming to move in. I'm coming to make my abode with you. He lived with Adam and Eve, and he want to come back and be restored to his rightful house. Amen. That's a promise. He said it, didn't he? He said, if I don't leave, I can't send back the Comforter. If I don't leave, I've heard so many people say, if Jesus were here, I would live better. Oh, he is here. If you here, you say he here. What was Satan doing back in the days of Job, walking with the sons of God? He was right in the middle of it. Don't forget that. Don't ever forget that. He was right in the midst. Amen. So, Jeremy, the two scriptures that I gave out. Pull up one of them. Pull up. So, Jesus' model for his followers, his disciples, the saints. I'm not going to use the word Christian. I'm going to wean myself off of that word, because only three times we found that when, what's the man's name? Paul told, he told Paul, you almost persuaded me to become a Christian. The word Christian was a derogatory term in Antioch, where the church, where they were first called Christians, it was a derogatory term. So the believers that believed in Jesus thought it was a badge of honor to wear that name, because it was a derogatory name. It was just like cussing somebody out. Jesus wasn't named, so that Christian name wasn't popular. But Jesus said followers. He said disciples. The Bible says saints, believers. The word Christians appears only three times, and God, Jesus never told anybody to call anybody Christian. So everybody's saved now. And I used to say this back in the late 90s. What kind of Christian are you? A lying Christian? Are you a stealing Christian? What do you mean? A Christian don't do that? Exactly. Christ like. Oh. Then they thought about it. Come on. God is not a man. Sinful man. He's not like men. You only know man because if you a man, you'll say, I know that. I'm a man just like you. I put my feet on. God ain't like that. That he should lie. Neither the Son of Man that he should repent. God ain't going to never say my bad. It's too many Christ-like people. Christians say my bad. Where that come from? You ever heard Jesus say my bad? That's a worldly term. If I said it, I'm going to make good on it. No, God cannot lie. Bobby had a good translation. That's that NIV translation. Is it right, Bobby? That's the NIV. So, and shall he not do it? Has he not said? Has he said? Has he promised? God is faithful. God is faithful. God is faithful. God has never not lied to me, not one day since I've been saved and trusted his word. I got results every time I dotted the I's and crossed the T. When God told me to do something, provision was waiting on me. He told the children of Israel through Moses, Moses, tell them I am sent you. Tell them I'm sending you to deliver them. God had already told Moses they coming out of Egypt. But they came out of Egypt and were letting go the worldly mindset. Egypt was a type of world, because when did they kept talking about going back? They kept talking about dying. No matter what God said to Moses, and Moses said to them, they never trusted God. They saw his power. They saw him turn the Nile River into blood. They saw him put the frogs and the lice and the cattle dying and all this stuff. But they never trusted God. They would praise God for the good time. Then when it got bad again, God would send them through a test. They would go to complaining. Is it any different today? And I say this, and I go to my grave believing this. The corona was a test. What did we hear from the church? What did we see? What did you hear? God showed us something. God told me, I'm judging the church. Church been judged and don't even know it. It's bad to be judged of something that happened and you don't even realize. You know a bigger thing about a con artist, he can bamboozle you and you don't know you've been bamboozled. That's bad. 10 years later, you done figured something out. Oh, I've been taken. God is not a man that he should lie. Is God trustworthy? Amen. Jesus modeled for his followers his relationship with the Father. What did Jesus put on display with the disciples he called, God called to follow him? What did he do? He put on a display of his relationship with his Father. He showed Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Thomas, and all them guys, Judas, even Judas, saw the same thing they saw. He demonstrated a relationship with God. What are we supposed to be doing? Why did Jesus model this? We got a copy. My wife said, read the book. Read about what Jesus did. So when I read about how Jesus interacted with the Father, guess what? I started doing that. I started saying only what the Father said. You know what? I found out saying what God said would get you in trouble with the people who say they love God. I was telling Bishop Donald and them, we was talking Friday night. I said, all of my trouble hadn't come through sinners. It came through the church. Sinners don't bother me. It's the people who love this book. All right. Next verse, Jeremy. Just setting this lesson up. Relationship. Relationship. God is faithful. Get that one. God is faithful. Now, how faithful am I? That's the next one. And the church said, well, God loves me. He died for me. He blesses me. He doing this for me. No, what are you doing? I ain't got to do nothing. All God told me to do is believe. Don't the church think that? Is that erroneous teaching? It is. God giving you his Holy Spirit just to believe? No. And ye shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. What do that mean? I like how the Amplified reads. When you, we'll read it from the Amplified. Put that, come on, Jeremy. And I will be found of you, says the Lord. Is God lying? I will turn away your, what did Jesus come to do? Destroy the works of the devil, didn't he? Then he said, I come to set the captives free. I come to heal the brokenhearted. He come to set the captivity, break the captivity. I will gather you from all nations, and from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, I will bring you again into a place whence I called you to be carried away. Now, if you read the story in the 28th chapter, Hananiah, the false prophet, after Jeremiah spoke what God said, he got up, broke a yoke off Jeremiah's neck and said, I broke the yoke of Babylon and you ain't going to serve but 2 years. After 2 years, you coming back here. He spoke in front of all them priests and got up in the assembly of God and spoke a lie. And he did not speak on behalf of God. And that's common today. Cut the TV on. You see all these false preachers and women on TV speaking, and they are not speaking from God. They not. It's the word of God, but they not called by God to do that. Peter Popoff is. Notice he always talking about the spring water. Always a check, ain't it? It ain't never. I stopped cussing my wife out. I took the miracle spring water. Oh, not no more the miracle spring water. Thank you, Peter Popoff. Ain't none of that. It's always a check. I laugh when I see it coming off. My wife be tickling. I be laughing at that. Anyway, I'm going to read this from the Amplified. And we're going to set this lesson up. All right. Number one, write this down. Jesus modeled full dependence upon the Holy Spirit. Amen. You want to get strengthened on the inner man? In the inner man? You want to get strengthened in the inner man? Okay. Jesus demonstrated, he modeled full dependence upon the Holy Spirit. Did he not? Did he not? What did the Holy Spirit do? Led him in the wilderness to be tempted. That was my first message. Hold on, let me read this right here. God, I'm going to start at 10. For thus says the Lord. I'm back in Jeremiah. This is the Amplified. I'm going to start at verse 10. 9. Give me 9. It says, for they prophesy falsely to you in my name. He's talking about this false prophet. And says the Lord. For thus says the Lord, when 70 years of exile have been completed for Babylon. I will visit and inspect you and keep my good promise. There you go. To you. To bring you back to this place to rule. But when they got back, was it tore down? Didn't he call Nehemiah to build it back? Build that wall back? It took 52 weeks to build that wall back. And that wall was thick. It was 8 inches thick. 8 feet thick, excuse me. For I know the plans and thoughts that I have for you. Do we trust God's plans? Says the Lord. Plans for peace, well-being, not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. To think about a future in this world and people shooting them up, killing up. What kind of future we going to have? God just spoke. I'm going to give you a future in the midst of all this mess. And I'm going to give you hope in the midst of all this mess. Ain't that a blessing? I got that promise. God can't lie. Well, it's so bad. I'm going to let God deal with the bad. I'm going to deal with the promise. I don't deal with, and this is what I tried to teach the church, Tam may remember this, and somebody else in here may remember. I don't deal with the I'm sick part. The part that ain't in the scripture. The part I deal with, I'm healed part. I don't need to deal with the sick part. I'm dealing with the I am healed. That's a promise. I embrace that. Okay? Okay? Jesus modeled all of this for us, did he not? Amen. So, that's the good about being in a relationship. We get to demonstrate our relationship with the Father. Our lives are on display, saints. So, it says, I know the plans and the thoughts I have for you, says the Lord, plans for peace and well-being. Peace and well-being. Without the strength, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit in the inner man, will you have peace? The Holy Spirit brings life and peace. To be carnally minded, for you, says the Lord, plans for peace and well-being, not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope. Watch this, verse 12. Then you will call on me, and you will come and pray to me. Every good relationship have good dialogue, not just monologue. How is it that people throw all this talk at God and say, amen? Father, you're going to do this for me, and you're going to do this for me, and you're going to do that for me, and I thank you, Lord. Okay, I can't do all the talking. My wife got to talk, so I let her talk. We talk, but with God, the church got to learn how to allow God to minister, talk back, because we're in a relationship, and let him tell us some things that he is requiring of us in this unique relationship. What if God had a wrote to my dearest children? Oh, how I love you. I ain't sending Jesus. Can't do it. Y'all remember that poem? To my dearest Betty. Oh, my vernacular can't even find the words to express my deepest love for you. Oh, if I had to swim across the Atlantic Ocean and you was on the other side, it would be a mere drop in a swimming pool. Because you would be waiting on me on the other side. He said, if I had to walk the Sahara Desert, you would be my oasis on the other side. He said, I'll see you Saturday night, my dearest Betty. P.S., if it rain, I ain't coming. See all that corn he was shucking? What kind of stuff is that? Sound good. What if God had wrote us a good love letter right here and didn't mean none of it? He gave you this so you'll know what he said. To you personally, God has promised each and every one of us, and he cannot lie. And he's fulfilling it as I speak right now. He has made good on everything he has said to me. Coming up to trust him. One thing the Holy Spirit will do when you're young and you don't know God like we should, he will get, the first thing God want to do is establish a trust to get you to trust him. So he's going to do some things to show you that you can trust him. So you can get rid of the fear and allow him to expose himself to you to show you that he's faithful. It's the first thing God did with me. He showed me now. You serve the devil with vigor and all this enthusiasm. I want the same thing. I want that passion that you gave the devil. I'm like, yeah, I did. Was enthusiastic about sin. He said, I want the same thing. Now, why would he tell me that? God is requiring that not just out of me. Sin was fun, wasn't it? Loud, enjoyable, all right? What about our relationship with God? It's so quiet. Shh, I want nobody to know I'm in with him. I done seen people marry and go places, and the person set away from the spouse didn't want nobody to know they were together. Shame up. What kind of relationship is that? Are we shame of Jesus? Are we? All right, listen. Then with a deep longing, you will seek me and require me as a vital necessity. Do we seek God as a vital necessity? If God don't do it, it can't get done. Is he vital? Is your heart vital? Is the blood in your veins vital? Is the air in your lungs vital? Well, God is vital. So then with a deep longing, that's a desire, you will seek me. That's what God wants. I've known people leave a house in a storm looking for cigarettes. When I didn't have them, I just didn't have them. I didn't go in the ashtray trying to straighten out them butts. I wasn't no avid smoker of cigarettes. Y'all fill in the blank. Y'all, somebody got it. I didn't say I didn't smoke. It just wasn't cigarettes. Listen, with a desire, I've seen people lead, I got to have a cigarette, man. Go get me a cigarette. But guess what? It still took God to help me off those cigarettes. He said, these cigarettes are not glorifying me. He was laying out the requirements in this relationship. God said, these cigarettes are not glorifying me. I was on lunch break. I know it was Jesus that saved my soul. I'm singing the song. He said, these cigarettes, I stopped puffing. I heard it, thumped it away, took the pack. I was about a big old dumpster outside. I mean, garbage, a barrel. I broke the pack of cigarettes up because I wasn't planning on smoking no more. I heard from God. What I learned from that, if when I obeyed what God said, the power in that command was enough to stop me from going back. When God speaks to us about something in our relationship that's written, ain't never heard of that. God said, don't put nothing unclean in your temple. That covers a multitude of things. So what I did was I thought and said, take them, Lord. The power to quit was they not glorifying me. And I stepped out on faith, and that was in 86. And smoked since. Didn't have a desire for a cigarette. He took it because I offered it up. The requirements gave me what he wanted of me. So I had to get that up. You hear me? So if you want what he wants, you got to meet his requirements. You got to go after God with everything. Now, you got to go after God. Are you going after him with all your heart as a vital necessity? You will find me when you search for me with all your heart. Jeremy, Deuteronomy 4:29-30, please. I will be found by you. God ain't lost, but you're going to run into God, says the Lord. And I will restore your fortunes. I will free you and gather you from all the country. Now, let me say this. When, as Jeremy Turner, when God told Israel to go into captivity in Babylon, guess what happened? Guess what happened? They prospered. Even in slavery, God blessed them. He said, gone into captivity, it's going to be well. If you go into bondage, it's going to be well. Them folk got blessed. What happened to Daniel? What happened to Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego? They was put over the king. Them, Israel, a lot of them didn't want to come back to Jerusalem because they got rich over in Babylon. When God said do something, he mean it. God know what he's doing. But if from thence thou shalt seek. What did I tell you to go? Okay, here we go. Yeah, that's it. But if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him. Why is it a repeat? Why God have Jeremiah repeating this? If thou seek him with all thy heart and with all thy soul. Why is this a repeat? Go to Deuteronomy 7, Jeremy. Let's read that a little bit while I'm there. I'm following the Holy Spirit. I'm going to follow the Spirit, and we need to get God is faithful to you, Bobby. God is faithful to you right now in what you're going through. God is right there. He ain't left you. We never know how we're going to leave this earth. We never know. That's why we don't know. We can't say. We just need to keep praying and thank God. Thank God, because we don't know. I don't know how I'm going to leave, but I'm going to give God my all. I told God I understand my purpose, and I'm running this race with vigor and gusto. I'm going. Come on. And when the Lord thy God shall bring thee into the land, whether thou goest to possess it, and has cast out many nations before thee, the Hittites, the Gershites, and the Amorites, and the Canaanites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites and the Jebusites, seven nations, listen to God, greater and mightier than you. See, God didn't choose you because you was all that. Listen, when the Lord thy God shall deliver thee before thee, thou shalt smite them, utterly destroy them, and utterly destroy them. God is giving them instruction with this relationship now that they're coming out of Egypt, didn't he? Now I'm going to move you into the promised land. You can't make no marriage covenant with them. Don't marry them. No, show no mercy unto them. What is the church saying today? Oh, they ain't got no mercy. Well, what'd they say? Don't show no mercy to these wicked folk out here. These nations were evil. And judgment has come up before God, and God was saying they was occupying the house till my people came. They was growing the big old juicy grapes for my people. They was gardening the garden for my people. The wealth of the wicked is laid up for the... You better know it here. Now, the reason why God said that, ain't don't supposed to be no sinners on earth. You get it? Don't supposed to be a number of holy people on earth serving God. That's what the intention. That's where we're going back to. So we need to get our minds renewed back to that. So I can't get a picture of a broken man, a effeminate man. All these commercials and all this, they pushing this, all this stuff. I can't get it because I got the picture of what God made the first man. I'm not buying into that. That's fallen man. I'm in the resurrection. I'm up and been restored. I can't accept that picture. I won't accept it. Come on. Neither shall thou make marriages with them. Thy daughters, thou shalt not give unto thy son, nor his daughters shall thy take unto thy son. Why? The Bible answers itself. For they will turn thy sons from following me. They may serve other gods. So when you leave God, you're serving Satan. That's right. But they were false gods. So will the anger of the Lord be kindled against you and destroy thee suddenly. God meant what he said. Because guess what? They said a golden calf brung us out of Egypt. Didn't it? They said a golden calf. They just come out of Egypt. They down at the bottom of Mount Sinai. Moses went up to get the commandments, and they down there hacking the food already. Wow. But if you look at that story, there's a lot going on with us today just like them. Ain't no different. Come on. But thus shall you deal with them. You shall destroy their altars, everything that ain't holy, destroy it, get rid of it. It's an altar, it's a worship center. Whatever you're putting before God is a God. That's an idol God. That's right. If God ain't first, that's an idol. If God ain't number one, well, he number one. Well, this is getting too much attention here. It's getting more attention than God. So it's an idol. And break down their images and cut down their groves and burn their graven images with fire. 6. Come on. For For thou art a holy people. Here we go. This is why. You are holy people under the Lord. You have his spirit. What's the Holy Spirit's job? Is to help you live holy. Your home become holy. The people become holy. The ministry become holy. The Holy Spirit's job is not just to strengthen you. That's part of it. It's not just to lead you. It is to help you to live a holy and consecrated life. Now, if the Holy Spirit is there, you should be becoming more holier, not unless holier. Get it? So if we're not becoming more holier and year by year holier and holier, we got to make an assessment. Is he there? Because if you ain't becoming no more holier, no more committed to God, and you becoming less committed, Holy Spirit ain't going to lead you to none of that. Jesus was led by the Spirit. The first thing Jesus did was model full dependence upon the Holy Spirit, did he not? All right, let's go to Matthew 3, and let's read. Watch this. Matthew 3 and 16. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were open unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending, it said, like a dove, not a dove, and lightning upon him. They saw the Spirit of God on it. John the Baptist saw it. Listen. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am what? Stop right there. Who did Jesus heal prior to getting baptized? Nobody. What good works did he do? He didn't. Why was the Father so pleased with Jesus? Somebody know the answer. He what? He lived by faith. That's how you please God. You live by faith. You got to live by faith. Everybody in here, it's impossible. Without faith, Jesus got disrespectful of Mary and Joseph. Jesus, why did you leave us when they went to pay taxes and came back? They assumed Jesus was up ahead in the caravan. They went looking for him. Jesus, nowhere to be found. They turned around and went back to Jerusalem. Where was he? In the temple. And I've heard preacher after preacher say Jesus was teaching. Jewish males did not start a ministry until they were 30. John the Baptist started his ministry at 30. Jesus started his ministry at 30. What was Jesus going to teach? What was he going to teach? He was disobedient. Then he had to learn obedience through the things he suffered. And the Bible said he went home, subject himself under his parents. And he grew. It came out in our Sunday school lesson. Terrence said, God is not going to trust you with no authority if you won't submit to him. Nobody in the earthly mind, no company is going to trust you when you won't submit to the authority of their company. God ain't going to just give you something. Now, you can have the Holy Spirit to qualify and say you is, but for him to turn up dunamis and a user on your life, you won't get it. You won't get it because you ain't proving yourself. You got to humble yourself. Okay? So, Jesus model, 4 and 1, Jeremy. 4 and 1, Matthew. 4 and 1. 4 and 1. What happened? Then, after the Father was pleased, what happened? Then was Jesus led up into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. I remember back on World News, Mama Abram, you might remember this. It's been a while back. I would say, this man got somebody to drop him off in the wilderness to try to do what Jesus did. He missed the first part of that verse. Put it back up there. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness. The Spirit didn't lead him. He went out there on his own. He liked to die. Why did he go there? Why did Jesus obey the Spirit? Jesus went out there knowing the ministry he's finna embark in. And the Spirit led him out there. But what happened? This was my first sermon, by the way. God was telling me, you going to win against the devil. You're trying to live right without me. You won't be able to do it. This is how you're going to do it. Come on, let's get to. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, being on a 40-day fast, y'all want to know what that 40-day fast did for me? It killed a lot of junk in me. It took 40 days to kill. And I told y'all the story. I had a problem with a brother in the ministry. I was pastoring, but I got tired of him. Now, I've done everything I could to meet him on common ground. I kept going. I kept initiating my presence with him. The more I initiated, the more he rejected. Okay? And God finally told me, go on a 40-day fast. And it took 40 days to bring peace into my life. See, that 40 days was for me because I was finna get in trouble. I was finna cross the line with God. And right after Katrina, God said, I want you to go on a juice fast, water and juice fast. I went on that juice fast. But, and still, right now, even now, I run into him. We cordial. We speak. I pray for him. When I ran into him the last time, I prayed an earnest prayer for him. Because what I saw, I felt sorry for him. I'm not putting him down, but I really feel sorry for him. And I knew why. Sometimes people can be intimidated by you or don't like you because of your walk with God. Mom Abram helped me to see that. She said, these preachers hate light. You light. They in darkness, and they know it. This is why they hate you. She had to help me. And for a long time, I said, Mom Abram, just blowing smoke. I ain't finna look at myself. I ain't no different than nobody else. God got me the other week. I said, Mom Abram, I called. I said, I apologize, and I appreciate it. I am different. I'm cut from a different cloth. I'm just going to accept it. I'm trying to be humble, but that ain't going to make me nothing but know that God chose me for a specific purpose. And I'm going to fulfill it. And God told me, you're not going to be liked. Not with what I'm going to have you to do. And it's been every bit of that. And I love it. Hate me. I don't care. I don't. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterwards he was what? What was the appetite about? Come on, let's talk about it. What was the appetite about? We finna find out. Jesus was out there thinking about how could he do his ministry. He went out there for that purpose because look at the ministry. He went out there. The Holy Spirit led him there. And he's thinking about ministry because as he leave out, he went and got Matthew. He went and got them brought, not Matthew, but them fishermen. He went to start his ministry, put it up there. Come on. And when the tempter came to him and said, yeah, you be the Son of God. Jesus wasn't worried about that. He knew who he was. See, we ain't figured out. I'm grandmama on Bessie May on my dad and my side, cousin, auntie, thrice removed from my mama's sister. All you had to do was say you're a child of God. We still in that earthly birth. Listen what he said. If you're the Son of God, use your power to command these stones to be made bread. The first thing I got out of that years ago, Jesus was hungry, so Satan tempted him with food. But as I grew up in the things of the Lord, he wanted Jesus to use his authority wrong. Now, let me go here. Why is it wrong to pray for money? Anybody? Why is it wrong to pray for money? Don't you know it's illegal for God to send money out of heaven to you? What did Jesus go hungry for? Food, bread, all right? What did Satan ask? Take stone. Where in the Bible did Jesus ever take stone to make bread? He needed more. Satan wanted him to use his power to make stones into bread. Now, didn't we see Jesus multiply fish and bread? Yeah. All right, he had to have fish and bread. In order to multiply your money, you need. And you praying for? Now, a Satan worshiper, murdering farmer, no, he got to put some seed in the ground. But what's wrong with God's people? Oh, bless me. You bless me. I need to pay my bill, Lord. You won't get it. Like, that's illegal. So, what did Jesus reply? What did he do? He was hungry. Now, what's your thirst? What's your hungry? Come on now, because Satan, Jeremy said it. Satan don't tempt me to fight anymore. He don't tempt me to do, to have sex and to do all this old crazy stuff because it's not in my spirit. Now, if it was still there, he would tempt me with it. And so those temptations don't come up no more because I rid it out of my spirit. So if you pressure to have sex, it's because it's on your mind. If you pressure to lie because he know you want to lie. If you want to tell the truth, Satan ain't going to pressure you to tell the truth. Satan is not going to tempt you to pay tithe. Satan is not going to tempt you to cut your neighbor yard. He's not. So, listen, he answered and said, what did he say? It is what that God promised us is written. Man, Jesus is quoting what? Yeah. He was a man modeling what? Right here. A man should not live. What did I give you the first one? Now, tie that first thing I gave you with this. What is he doing? He's modeling full dependence on the Holy Spirit. Spirit led him now. In the Spirit, my word is spirit in his life. Come on. That's what he's doing. Should not live by what? Bread alone. But by every word, every word, every word, every word that proceeds out. 2 Timothy 3:16. All scriptures are given by the inspiration of God. Out of the mouth of God. Not out of the preacher's mouth. I told this guy, I don't believe nothing the preacher say. He knew I was a preacher, and he took thought it was a good way to take a shot at me. Yeah, preachers this, preachers that. I don't trust nothing they say. I said, you got a book? How well do thou read it? That's what I asked. I read pretty good. I said, well, tell you what, read it for yourself. You believe you, don't you? I said, you believe you? You trust you? Yeah, I trust me. Read it. I said, you any more believing now than you read? I said, you just don't want to obey God. You got nothing to do with no preacher. Anyway, come on. The devil taketh them up into a holy city and setteth them on a pinnacle of the temple. Wow, come on. He said unto him, if, there you go again, you be the Son of God. Cast thyself down. This is scripture, Psalm 91 and 11. Satan is quoting scripture now. He saw Jesus, okay. Satan is a counterfeit. All right? You, like I said, you got Jordan, you got Gordons. You got, it go. Satan does counterfeit. So he said, you want to quote scripture? Wait a minute, I know God. I know the scripture. I used to be an angel myself, so he gave angels charge concerning you, that if you're in danger, you're going to get delivered if you're here. God got angels encamped about us. And he's saying they lying, now he's telling the truth. In their hand, they should bear thee up, least at any time you dash your foot against a stone. Listen to what Jesus said. Come on, come on. Why? Here comes Jesus with the word again. And Jesus said unto him, it is written again. It is written again. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles and tricks of the devil. We got to learn this in our relationship with God. You got to learn to trust and depend on the Holy Spirit through the word spirit. These words come off of God's mouth, saints. These are promises to you. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. I'm going to walk out in front of this traffic. I know God is going to save me. We're going to be singing, nearer my God to thee. Flat as a pancake, God, yeah, you don't tempt God. You don't tempt God. Come on. Y'all get the picture? Again, the devil taketh them up into an exceedingly high mountain. This is a temptation in the mind. Satan can't take Jesus nowhere. It's a mind thing. He's in your mind upon the mountain. Show them all the kingdoms of the world. All the kingdom of the world. How did Satan get the kingdom of the world? Took them from Adam and Eve. And he'll take your authority, you let him. Did God give Satan authority over you? Jesus said, Pilate, you ain't got no authority over me. Amen. And showed them all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of what made them tick. Now, I want you to get deep into this. He showed him Hollywood. He showed them all the gay activity in Hollywood. Jesus was tempted with homosexuality. He was tempted with women. He was tempted with money. How are you going to judge you if he ain't been tempted? We have not an high priest that cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. So he know what it's like to be tempted. So he can be sympathizing with you when he judge you. Oh, a guy came to Bible class that night. He got hot when I said that. He came back and apologized. I said, I went home and studied. Good. Well, you were right. Know the Bible right, sir. It wasn't me. I just speak for God, and I'm going to say what he say. And you say what he say. Heaven will bag you. He said, unto him, all these things I give you. Jesus didn't want this mess. Not in the form that Satan showed it. So Jesus knew he was going to get it back, but it was going to be recreated. We coming back to earth to live, y'all. I will give thee, and thou wilt fall down. And what was Satan after? What Paul Mormon saying? Bow down and worship. Satan wanted to be worshipped. He wanted to be God. And Jesus said, you can't serve two masters. So Jesus went out there. Was he committed to God? Come on. Yeah, come on. Come on, Jerry. Then Jesus said unto Satan, get thee hence. For it is written. It is written, y'all. These are promises. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and only him shall thou serve. Well, come on. 11. Is it 11? He said, watch this. Then the devil leaveth him for a season. The word, he got stuck up so bad. Can you see him limping away from Jesus? You better, he'll limp from you if you stick him enough. What that tear? Look up inside that wall right there. That's what you're sticking him with. A scaffold, baby. Yeah. In the name of Jesus. I thought you loved it, me. I do. In the name of Jesus. Get away from me. You sticking him. Then the devil leaveth him. And behold, angels came and did what? He was a man. They ministered unto Jesus. They gave him strength. And he come out of that wilderness. And he went about starting his ministry. So what did Jesus model? And we, look what time is. We're going to be, I got a few more things I want to do here. So, Luke 10 and 21, Jeremy, pull that up. Jesus modeled full dependence on the Holy Spirit. What did Jesus do to get out of that? Out of that temptation? What did you do? Now, I'm going to tell you this. This is how I got out of some stuff. Well, when things did come up on me and I want to grab somebody, I want to do this, I took my mind off the grabbing, or off the doing, and put my focus on him. Looking unto Jesus, and I begin to sing praise song. I begin to study. Guess what? Temptation eased up because I took my mind. I was like, yeah, because you won't let it go. Let it go and put your mind on Jesus. Pick the word up. You'll feel a release. I'm telling you now. God ain't lying to you. His promises are yes and amen. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced. In that hour, listen, what did he do? Rejoiced in the Spirit. We got to rejoice in the Spirit. And said, Father, I thank thee. I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth. Thou hast hid these things from the wise and the prudence and has revealed them unto babes. I didn't choose you because you were more and all that. I chose you because you were what? The least. God chose you. And so he revealed them unto us when we humble ourselves. Children. Depend. Look at how Jairus depended on Mecca and how this little girl and our children depends on us. Lana, you depend on your mom and dad, don't you? If when you go to the refrigerator, are you shaking? Lord, let it be some food. No, let it be some chicken nuggets and some pizza and all that. It ain't nothing to eat. It's plenty of food in there. That ain't what you like. I like them things too. I'm telling over self. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced, okay, all right, from the wise and the prudent, and has revealed them unto babe, even so, Father, for so it seems good in thy sight. What did he do? There go that word, Spirit. He rejoiced in the Spirit. He gave thanks in the Spirit. Jesus depended on the Spirit. Saints, what we got to do in this relationship? God is a Spirit. God is a Spirit. God is a Spirit. We got to depend on your spiritual relationship. You get the Spirit right, the natural is going to line up. You get the Spirit right. God, Jesus, man, woman, family, it lines up. Jesus depended on the Holy Spirit. Number two, write this down. Jesus modeled the centrality of prayer in his life. Did he not? Did he not? Luke 16 and 12. Luke 16 and 12. Luke 16 and 12. Luke 16 and 12. I'm sorry. Wait a minute. Luke 6 and 12. I said 16. I do it all the time. I'm sorry. And we notice Jesus did this often right here. Luke 6 and 12. I'm sorry, 16 and 12. And it came to pass in those days, he went out into a mountain, a secluded place. Let me tell you one thing. When you expend and release and use your spirit, you need to revive it. You need to get in a quiet place with God. Jesus often did that. Jesus healed people. He used that and it wore him out. He had to go charge his battery. He had to go charge his battery. But now you're going to meet some saints, and this is not what we are. And we're going to have to be very careful. This ain't what we are, walking around here looking to boost people up. That ain't what God told you to do. Now, if you're a pastor, that's a whole different job. My job is to make sure your battery up. My job is, that's my job, but as you, that ain't your job walking around here with spiritual booster cable on. Want everybody to see your cable. You need a jump, man. Man, your light was flashing 2 weeks ago. We don't see nothing now. Man, hey, dog, I'm all right. I'm still saved. No, you got to leave him alone. Well, I got these things wrapped up. Whoa, what's going on? No, that ain't what God wants us to do, saint. That is not what he wants us to do. This is not who you are. This is not who you are right here. Come on. This is not who we are. Came to pass. He went in the spirit out in the mountain to pray and continued all night. Wait a minute. When Jesus was in the garden, told the disciples, come watch and pray. And all the power was in Jesus. He couldn't keep them up. Now, what's in you going to keep them up? Come here. That ain't what we do. Come here, Joe. Gongo. What that thing, fibrillator, whatever that thing is. We ain't doing it. That ain't what we do. All night. What'd he do? Come on. Went into a mountain to pray and continue all night in prayer to God. And I guarantee you, when Jesus come out of that mountain from praying, he knew his assignment. He knew if he had to heal somebody, he knew he was going to run into the woman with the issue of blood. And God gave him what he needed to do the work. You got to refresh that spirit. Don't run yourself down. And let me share this with you. I was telling Bishop Donnelly, I remember we was in the Raggedy Building. I had just started to preach. I was like 30, been preaching a couple of years. I was in my early 30s. And I burned out Saturday, Sunday morning. I had to go preach at another church. Got up there and went to preaching and run out of gas and word. Because I preached out here when the building would turn this way. I mean, I was drained. I couldn't do nothing. It was just like, God said, you know what happened? You preached everything out in you. He said, now, what you're going to learn to do is preach off overflow. I preach off overflow now. I don't preach off because I fill a cup. Keep it full. I learned from that. That has never happened to me, and I'm telling you, stay full. Feel. Study. 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 Keep the word in you. Keep it filled so you won't run out. Jesus stayed locked up with the Father when they was on the shore, on the boat. And they was to see it roll up. They saw Jesus coming out of the mountain. They thought they saw a spirit. And they cried out. Jesus said, be of good cheer, as I. Jesus came to him. Peter said, Lord, if you bid me to come unto you. He said, C-O-M-E. He didn't say, wait a minute, Peter. Let me preach a sermon on walking on the water. No, he didn't do all that. Come, Peter. C-O-M-E was enough to defy gravity so Peter could walk on water. Don't you know more than C-O-M-E? Wait a minute now. Don't you know more than C-O-M-E? Yeah. So we ought to be walking above and not beneath. Come on. Come on. And when it was day, he called unto him his disciples And of them he chose. He was in prayer. He was in prayer who he would choose. Father already told him, and he chose the 12 whom he would name apostles. He depended on prayer, saints. He depended on prayer. He depended on prayer. How is your conversation with God? How you talk to other people? The way I talk to my maven, the way I talk to Terrence, all of you, I talk to God the same way. I'm honest with God. I don't do let there be in English, dear kind heavenly Father. That I don't do thus is in thou. King James was written in old let there be in English. Talk to God straight up, straightforward. If you don't know how to pray, but we know how to pray, Father, in the name of Jesus. But sometime I said, Lord, you know what I was thinking was wrong. That wasn't right. Lord, what you going to do about this? I told God this the other day. So-and-so, so-and-so. He showed me. Showed me through my wife. Showed me through my daughter. And then he showed me through something else just that quick. He said, no more questions. Gotcha. I said, Lord, because you always usually tell me what's next. You ain't said nothing. He got me. First somebody you with my wife. I'm like, huh? Then he used my daughters. I'm like, huh? Then he used somebody else. I'm like, what? Look at God. Who is that? Jerry. All right, in my closing, I give one more. Number three. Jesus modeled the importance of obedience to his Father's will. Did he not? Did he not? Jesus modeled the importance of obedience to his Father's will. Now, Jesus did those three things, and we are in a relationship with God. He's modeled that for us. So we can learn that. I learned how to play baseball by watching. I had a coach, but I watched the older guys play. I learned how to play football watching older guys. I learned how to play cards by watching people play cards. I learned how to skate by watching people skate. I didn't get good at it until I put some skates on. But we had them old iron skates. You couldn't skate on them. They got on them good skates like the broke my neck four times. So what I'm saying is, we learn by watching. What God is wanting, and we're going to close on this one. What God is really wanting us to do, we got to model like Jesus. We got to put our lives on display, on point, every day. Because people ain't listening to what we're saying, but they're watching how we living. Put your life on display. Live to convict. If ain't nobody getting convicted by your life, that's okay. They might not be doing it right now, but clean your life up. Do what you need to do and watch how they go to messing with you. Here they come with their holy self. Hey, I told some folks I'm holier than you. Next, anybody else? You ain't finna make me feel guilty about my relationship with God. As jacked up as I was, messed up as I was, and I'm going back to that because you don't like how my life is turning out. I wish. So, Jesus model, number one, full dependence on the Holy Spirit. Guess what he modeling that for? Us. We got it in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, don't we? Yes. Number two, Jesus model the centrality of prayer. I could have pulled up a whole bunch of scriptures. We, our Father, who are in heaven, teach us to pray. We need to learn to pray that prayer. His life and ministry. Amen. Number three, Jesus modeled the importance of obedience to his Father's will. And we'll pick it up from there next Sunday. This is my message for today. We got to learn and to trust our relationship with the Father. Thank you.